So I've got this Cummins 6BT here. And I also have a clutch for this Cummins 6BT. So the clutch goes right here between the back of the engine and the transmission. It's what mates the engine to the transmission. I also have this NV4500 here. Now this is a 5-speed manual transmission. You can see there's the shifter. And this one came out of a Chevy. And the issue is that if I try and take this and put it here, see, it doesn't really fit. This transmission is not going to mate up to the engine. But I also have a new input shaft. This is the shaft that sits right like this. And this shaft and this clutch do in fact fit together. So in order to get this transmission bolted to this 6BT engine, I'm gonna have to use this input shaft in the transmission. So let's get to work. Well, the transmission's full of gears. That was unexpected. So this is what the inside of a manual transmission looks like. There's this shaft full of gears, and underneath it is another shaft also full of gears. The thing that your hand's connected to is this shaft right here. And when you move that shaft up and down, these move. Now what these shift forks do, those shift forks go around these shift sleeves and push them into and out of mesh with each other. Now these sleeves have multiple positions. It can go forward like that, or it can go back like that. And that's what you're feeling when you can push upwards on the shifter and back on the shifter. That's moving this up and back and connecting it to different gears. Now the thing to keep in mind on these is what if this gear is spinning really fast and the gear underneath it isn't spinning as fast? How do you make it so they mesh? The way you do that is the teeth here, they're on this little bronze ring, this little brass ring. And as you try to force these gears together, that brass ring will provide friction, which will speed up the shaft to meet the speed of the other shaft. So those are wear parts, those are your synchronizers. And you wanna make sure that your synchronizer teeth look good, that there's nothing wrong with them. I'm not seeing any wear inside of here. Of course, I'd have to take it apart a lot more than this to get a good idea, but the piece I need is the input shaft right here. So I just need to unbolt this so that I can pull this shaft out the front. So let's do that. Notice all these gears spin at different speeds because they're different sizes. That's where the magic of the transmission comes from. Now that I have the old shaft out, I need to get this bearing from here to here. Now, there's a couple ways I can do this. First thing is a bearing splitter. That would be the best way, but I don't have one and I wasn't able to find anywhere in town that had one, but a bearing splitter would be the best way. The other thing you could try that I've seen some people do is if you hold this shaft with a wet rag and then you heat up the inner race, then you might be able to get the shaft to stay cold enough and the bearing to get hot enough that it expands enough to just drop off there. So that would be another option. The option I'm gonna go with is going to be, I actually got new bearings for it. So I wasn't able to find a bearing splitter locally, but I was able to find the bearing. What I need to do is I need to get this race pressed into the end cap that I took off the front of the transmission here, and then I need to press this bearing onto the shaft here. So, let's do it. That freaking sucked. Got the race out, but that was terrible. I'll cut out most of the audio on those clips because you don't need to hear me cussing and throwing tools across the shop. So what I ended up doing was I used a hole saw to cut out this plate, and then I welded it all the way around. And welding it put a ton of heat into this thing, so while it was still hot, I basically filled this up with water, which causes this race to shrink, and then I was just able to hammer it out. But if the water trick hadn't worked, I would have just pressed this out from the back using the press. The first time I tried to do this, all I did was weld on this little strip, and as you can see, when I tried to press it out, that just broke. So had to go full weld, full plate, all the way around to make that work. They make a tool to do this. Don't be like me, just buy the tool. The reason I didn't is because I don't think I'll ever have to do this again. But my philosophy is, the first time you need a tool, go ahead and do it the janky way or borrow one from somebody or do something like that. But if you ever need a tool a second time, you need to go buy it because you're gonna need it a third and a fourth if you've already needed it twice. So if I ever have to do this again, I will buy the tool. If I can find one online that looks decent, I'll probably put a link in the description. This worked fine. If you don't have a welder, get the tool. Even if you do have a welder, probably get the tool because that was a pain in the butt. This method did work okay though once I decided to go full send and just do a full plate in the middle. All right, so now what I need to do is take the new race and press the new race into here and then press the bearing onto the shaft. Once I do that, I can throw everything back together. So let's get to it. Got that race pressed in. And now what I need to do is press the other bearing onto the other shaft. The only issue is that this outer race sticks up higher than the inner race. Meaning if I put something on this and try and push the bearing onto the shaft, it's gonna ruin that outer race. I'm gonna use another trick with heat. In fact, honestly, using these tricks, I could have done this whole job without a press. So remember, the hotter something is, the more it expands. So if you put the inside part cold and the outside part hot, they'll slip right together, and then when they equalize temperature, it'll be a nice press fit. So if it's a slip fit with a huge difference in temperature, then it's going to be a press fit when they're the same temperature. That was way too easy. I think they were there for less than 30 minutes, and as you saw, it just slipped right on. That's the magic of a shrink fit. I could have done that with the inner bearing race as well, and then I wouldn't have even needed a press at all to do this job, so that worked well. Shrink fits. Well, I screwed up again. And I only noticed it after I covered this in right stuff, unfortunately. But this shaft is 1 1/4 inch. The old shaft is 1 1/8 inch. I knew that, but I guess what I didn't realize is that the tolerance on this hole here is actually really tight. That's just over 1 1/8 inch. So this does not fit. This is the wrong cover. This is like the transfer case all over again. I'm actually gonna go see if I can find another one of these covers, but I'll fix that problem off camera, assuming these are easy to find. I'll buy one and throw it on later once it comes in. For now, let's get the top of the transmission back on And then you would have seen everything that was important in this build anyways. Let's get the top of this put back on. All back together except for the stupid mistake I made here. As you can see, you can actually do the input shaft without taking the top off, but then you don't get to look inside and it can be a little trickier if you drop something or anything. So I chose to take the top off, but you don't have to do that. Got the top back on, shifts perfectly smooth, all the gears work. So that is how not to do the input shaft on an NV4500, but once I get that part, it should bolt up to the Cummins. So that'll be great. That'll be, the whole drivetrain will be able to bolt back together at that point. If you got anything from this video or if it was entertaining, then please like it. If you want to see the rest of this Cummins Explorer build, then subscribe and stick around. And thanks for hanging out in my garage with me today. See you next time.